Madam?
Yes, yes. Smita, you can start. It is visible.
Good evening, the teachers, my seniors, and dear friends. First of all, I thank
Smita, I think you are not audible. You can increase your volume.
Am I audible, madam?
Yes, yes, okay.
Thank you, Bennett sir and Priya madam, for giving me this opportunity. So going to the topic, it's a very vast topic. I have tried to include as many as possible. And if I'm running, means over time, please tell me, I'll stop. Okay, thank you. So I'll be dealing with common dermatosis in pediatric OP practice. So as you all know, skin is the largest and the most superficial organ in the body. And we all know that our pediatric outpatient visits, around 40% of the patients are cases of pediatric dermatology. And skin again is a window to other systemic illness other than its primary skin disorders. So how do you approach a case of a dermat case? So first and foremost, as in any specialty, history is very important for diagnosis. You have to get a history about how the lesion started, how it has progressed, any associated lesions, etc. And you have to carefully examine the lesion and the skin surface. The first and foremost thing is you have to identify the primary lesions. I'll be telling about the primary lesions later. You have to find the size of the lesions. Then you have to look for secondary changes, the color of the lesions, how the lesions are arranged, like linear, annular, etc. And where is it, the predominant sites like flexural, face, everything has a, everything, and all these things help us to come to a diagnosis. And not only the lesion, we have to examine the whole body, you have to examine the mucosa, hair, nails, everything under adequate illumination. So coming to, I told about the primary skin lesions. This primary skin lesions means that is the initial pathological change which happens in the disease. And secondary skin lesions, these are the result of external forces. Like if you scratch, pick, or when it heals, or you give take any treatment, all this can cause secondary changes on the primary lesion. So coming to the primary lesions, I'm not going into detail of everything. You all know macule, that is just a skin, flat skin color change. Next is the papule, which is an elevated lesion less than 1 centimeter. A plaque, which is again a bigger flat lesion, raised lesion, more than 1 centimeter.
Smita, can you speak a little louder?
Okay, madam.
Can you speak a little louder?
Can you hear me now? Madam, can you hear me?
Yes. For
Madam, can you
hear
me? Okay. Now can you hear me, madam? Hello?
Keka. Parnyolu. Smita Keka.
So the other lesions are like nodule, beads, etc. And coming to the secondary skin changes, these are scales, erosions, scars, lichenification due to excessive scratching and all. Some primary lesions are like vesicle, bulla, cyst, and pustules. And secondary lesions, excoriation due to intense scratching, fissure developing after a drying of the lesion, and keloid. These are secondary lesions. So that is basically we should be knowing this morphological patterns to diagnose various dermatoses. So the common thing I'm planning to discuss today is infections caused by bacterial, viral, and fungal infections, then infestations, some disorders of pigmentation, some papillosquamous disorders and vascular reactions, and atopic dermatitis. So coming to the topic, first is infections. This is the most common thing which we are seeing in our practice. So coming to the bacterial, superficial bacterial infections, first is impetigo. So this is a superficial bacterial infection caused by Staph aureus, most commonly, followed by group A beta streptococcus. What you see is superficial vesicle, which ruptures easily, and the characteristic honey-colored crust. These are the secondary lesions which are formed. There is another entity called bullous impetigo. It starts at the bulla. Bulla is the bulla vesicle. This is a superficial bulla, and it will leave back a round erythematous erosion after that. And the site, like this, is most commonly involving the exposed areas. And as we all know, this spreads by autoinoculation. So that is what you are seeing in this child. You can see this excessive spreading of the lesion because of autoinoculation. So this is in the picture, you can see that is a bullous impetigo. The bulla has ruptured and you can see a flat erosion there. So how do you treat impetigo? First and foremost, as I told you, there will be crusting. So you have to debride the crust. You use clear water compresses or saline compresses, and we need to debride the crust first. Then for milder lesions, we can apply topical mupirocin or any topical antibiotic, fusidic acid. And if there is widespread involvement, you need to give systemic antibiotics. So you have to give it for 7 to 10 days. We prefer an antibiotic which covers the staph aureus. Cephalexin and cefadroxil are the ones I prefer. You can even give mox and mox glove also. And one complication we'll have to think here is if there is nephritogenic strains involved, it can lead to AGN. So we need to watch for that also. The second commonest superficial bacterial infection is the folliculitis. Again, that is an inflammation of the hair follicle. In the picture, you can see there is an inflammation and pustule on the hair follicle. Most common cause. And in acne, again, as you see in acne, here the gram-negative organism causes folliculitis in acne. And you can see folliculitis in the back. It is most commonly caused by this fungus, Pityrosporum, which is a common cell. So the most predisposing cause for folliculitis is warm and humid climate, obesity, diabetes, and immunodeficiency. So you can just see the folliculitis is a superficial bacterial infection involving a single hair follicle. The picture you have seen there. Now next is furuncle. Furuncle is again, it's a perifollicular superficial bacterial infection. In this picture, you can see this hair follicle and the surrounding area and is also inflamed and infected. When contiguous hair follicles are involved and perifollicular areas are involved, we call it a carbuncle. So all these are superficial bacterial infection caused by the almost the same organisms, but the clinical picture varies. So this picture, the one on the forehead, it is a furuncle. You can see a follicle infected and the perifollicular inflammation. And on the right side, you can see it's a carbuncle. That is multiple follicular follicles and perifollicular units are involved and it is infected, and it's also abscess formation is also there. So this is folliculitis, furunculosis, and carbuncle. So treatment, main thing, as I told you, general hygiene is very important. When there is scaling, crusting, abscess, you need to give compresses and give topical antibiotics. Never apply any topical application on any oozing lesion. You have to give compresses, dry the lesion, then only give any topical preparation. That applies to eczemas, bacterial infections, etc. Then we can give oral antibiotics, as I told you, which one covers staphylococcus and streptococcus. And there are some people, they get recurrent furunculosis or this impetigo, it is recurring. So these people might be they will be carriers for this organisms. So for those patients, we can give intranasal mupirocin. We can give it for 7 to 10 days. And for severe people with severe recurrences, we also give rifampicin. Next superficial bacterial infection, eczema. Again, this is a superficial bacterial infection caused by Streptococcus pyogenes. It starts as a painful papule with surrounding erythema, and later it will proceed on to form a crusted ulcerated papule. If you remove the crust, you can see a ulcer in the base. Treatment is again similar to our superficial bacterial infections. you'll be giving compresses followed by oral antibiotics and topical antibiotics. Next superficial infection we commonly see is erysipelas. So this is a superficial bacterial infection of the skin involving the subcutaneous tissue and lymphatic vessels. Okay, it's caused by beta hemolytic streptococcus. The characteristic feature is that you can see there is a well demarcated, sharply marginated lesion, and it's tender, edematous, and also there will be systemic involvement like malaise and fever can also be there. It's because mainly due to the involvement of the lymphatic vessels. So the characteristic feature in erysipelas is this well demarcated red tender swelling. The main differential diagnosis is cellulitis. Cellulitis again is a infection, a bacterial infection involving the subcutaneous tissues, but there the cellulitis is not this sharply demarcated. It is a diffuse swelling with tender swelling. Now erysipelas, its most common site is face, and limbs are the most common, followed by face, and sometimes in infants abdominal wall is also involved. The treatment, Moxclav is the better one. This is penicillin is given in the books. Moxclav will be a better choice to cover streptococcus. Next, one serious condition we see in our practice is Staphylococcus Calditzin syndrome. Not very common, but we still see these cases. It's caused by Staphylococcus aureus because of its epidermolytic toxin A. And the characteristic thing is it starts as a macular scarlatiform rash, and it usually follows a respiratory infection or any skin infection. And the characteristic feature of SSS is that it first appears around the periorificial region, and perioral region is a very common site, followed by flexures like axillae, etc. So initially the skin becomes wrinkled, and then it cracks and it leaves raw erosions. The baby will be toxic and it will develop bullae and Nikolsky sign, that is when you push the epidermis, there is separation of the area of the epidermis in response to the pressure. So Nikolsky is positive. Treatment, as you all know, we have to cover staph aureus, cloxacillin is given, clindamycin is a topical agent, and you have to correct the fluid and electrolyte imbalance because the whole body is involved. This is the exfoliative dermatitis happening, to correct the fluid and electrolyte balance and clean the this with the isotonic saline. Next, coming to superficial and fungal infection, the most common we see is candidiasis. As you all know, Candida albicans is a normal flora, and the clinical cases we see most commonly due to this is intertrigo, oral thrush, angular chelitis, and chronic paronychia. And coming to each lesions, chronic paronychia, it's commonly seen in thumb suckers, child who sucks thumb, nail biters, etc. And fingernails are most commonly involved. What we see is, in the figure you can see a non-tender erythematous swelling of the nail bed, area surrounding the nail. And you can see there is the loss of cuticle on the nail, and you can see associated nail dystrophy and also separation of the nail from the bed. So this chronic wetting is the reason. So we have to avoid trauma and keep the area dry as possible. And oral fluconazole, single for chronic paronychia, we can give weekly dose in the dose of 8 mg per kg per week, and a topical imidazole cream. Imidazole cream, these are clotrimazole, the newer ones, luliconazole, everything can be given topical for chronic paronychia. The main thing is you have to treat it for 4 to 6 weeks. So treatment need to be continued for 4 to 6 weeks. Next common lesion seen is intertrigo. That is a superficial inflammatory dermatosis involving the flexural areas. heat, moisture, friction, and sweat retention are the most common cause. And the characteristic lesion is the maceration. You can see the macerated areas in the flexures. And these lesions can secondly get infected by bacteria and fungus. So coming to Candida and intertrigo. Intertrigo can be caused by lots of causes. Candida, tinea, again flexural psoriasis, seborrheic dermatitis. There are a lot of differential diagnoses for intertrigo. The most common we see is because of candidiasis. Here, the flexures are involved. And the characteristic lesions of Candida, you can see superficial transient pustules. And in the second picture, you can see the satellite lesions, that is papules and pustules in the adjoining areas. So these are the characteristic features of Candidal intertrigo. And the treatment for Candidal intertrigo, we have to keep the area dry and topical antifungals, that is imidazole, as I told you, clotrimazole. Miconazole is the one which is more preferred in pediatrics, pediatric age group. Clotrimazole and miconazole are very good agents. And to keep the area dry, we can even give dusting powders, so antifungal dusting powders. Now I'll be discussing this diaper dermatitis along with this because this is a close DD. Diaper dermatitis, again, it is a irritant contact dermatitis. It's due to the occlusion and due to the contact with feces and urine. Usually this diaper dermatitis, it gets secondary infection by Candida. So in diaper dermatitis, the characteristically, the rash involved the convex areas of the perineum. And the flexures are characteristically spared in this contact diaper dermatitis. And when there is a secondary infection with the Candida, then the flexures are involved. And we can see the satellite lesions, etc. And sometimes prolonged contact, it can lead to some ulcer, small ulcers over this diaper area. And that ulcers, we call it Jacquet's ulcer. So the management is, we have to keep the diaper area dry. We have to remove the contact, means decrease the contact period. We have to change the diaper frequently. Then mainstay is mild topical steroids. Mild topical steroids, hydrocortisone, desonide, and clobetasone. These are the mild topical steroids which we can use for diaper dermatitis. It is a irritant contact dermatitis. But if there is superadded candidal infection, you'll have to first give a topical antifungal followed by steroid. And zinc creams are given, diaper creams are given for protection before wearing the diapers. Next common condition, candidal condition we see is anaural thrush. It's usually seen in young infants. You can see discrete white plaques with an erythematous base. The oral cavity is the oral cavity. The child is irritable and it feeds poorly. And if it is persisting, we have to rule out immunodeficiency. The treatment is topical clotrimazole solution. Ceftriaxone is also available. And oral fluconazole can be given in resistant cases. Oral fluconazole dose is 6 mg per kg, single dose. Next is angular keelitis or perlish. It is due to repeated licking, drooling, thumb sucking, and you can see erythema and fissuring in the angle of the mouth. Sometimes it can be an extension of the oral thrush. So what we give is topical antifungals and topical, if there is inflammation is there, we can give topical steroids, mild topical steroids. Other angular keelitis is not always due to Candida. There can be other causes like seborrheic dermatitis, atopy, etc. That there will be surrounding changes, other changes along with this. The next common fungal infection we see is onychomycosis. Again, this is a dermatophytic infection. So it's caused by Trichophyton rubrum, mantegrophytes, and epidermophyta. It's common in adolescents and adults. And onychomycosis, it most commonly involves toenails more than fingernails. So here you can see the nails are thickened and they are separated from the nail bed. You can see this powdery white scales and even discoloration of the nails. There will be nail dystrophy also. Usually onychomycosis doesn't involve all the nails at one time. There can be one or two nails might be involved. Later on only, it can go and spread into multiple nails. But in case of some chronic, some papillomavirus disorders and disorders of nail, usually more nails will be involved. So that is one differential diagnosis, how we differentiate fungal infection from other nail disorders. So, and this onychomycosis, it is usually associated with Thinea pedis. And for onychomycosis, we need to give oral therapy and we give pulse therapy. And if it is toenails are involved, we have to give it for 12 weeks. Fluconazole, terbinafine and itraconazole are the drugs we usually give. And topical preparations like amorolfin, these are antifungals, amorolfin and cyclopirox. You have to do scaling of the nail and we apply this preparation. And again, you have to apply it for 12 weeks. Another common condition which we see in pediatric age group, a dermatophytic infection, is that a dermatophytic infection of the scalp. Again, the Thinea capitis, again, there are two varieties of Thinea capitis. There is an inflammatory Thinea and a non-inflammatory Thinea. Non-inflammatory Thinea, it is caused by Trichophyton tonsurans. So here you can see patch of partial alopecia and you can see broken hairs. Sometimes we see endothrix means the hair shaft is infected by the fungus and you can see black dots there. And there is one gray patch variety of Thinea capitis where you can see scaling similar to seborrheic dermatitis. And then others are the inflammatory Thineas. It is caused by microsporum canis because animal dermatophytes. So there will be intense inflammation and crusting, oozing and crusting in the of the hair shaft and the scalp. So that is inflammatory Thinea, which is called Kerion. So the diagnosis is by skin scraping and KOH examination, where you can see fungus, hyphae and spores. We can do culture for identifying the species. The main modality of treatment is oral griseofulvin. We have to give it at 20 mg per kg per day for minimum 4 to 6 weeks. Up to 8 weeks, it can be given. Another alternative is terbinafine, which is given at 3 mg per kg per day for 2 to 4 weeks. Then, as I told you, ketoconazole shampoos can also be given for cleansing the scalp. Then, topical antibiotics can be given if there is secondary infection. Another common skin fungal infection is Thinea corporis. I'm adding all this together, crurus, which involves the perineal region and pedis of the foot. So what do we see here is, characteristically, we see annular lesions with the central clearing and the advancing erythematous edge. This is the characteristic feature in the dermatophytic infections. So on the active edge, you can see vesicles and pustules. And if you do a skin scraping again and do a KOH mount, we can see the hyphae. So this is these are the pictures of Thinea crurus. The other is Thinea pedis along with this onychomycosis, Thinea fasciae. You can see the central clearing and peripheral extension of the lesions. Another important entity which we are seeing a lot nowadays is Thinea incognito. That is a steroid abuse Thinea. Many people are using steroid combination antifungal creams for Thinea infection. So here what we see is extensive lesions will be seen. This is less scaly than the normal Thinea and the margins will be less raised, but you can see more pustules there because of secondary infection. and there will be severe itching. The itching, when a patient with tinea incognita comes, the itching is very, very severe when compared to a person who comes with a primary tinea lesion. And because of the abuse of steroid, we can even see atrophy, striae, purpura, and telangiectasias over that lesions. Next, another common, very common fungal infection we see is pityriasis versicolor, caused by Pityriasporum orbicular and Malassezia parvovirus. These are lipophilic fungus. This is a normal commensal, and the clinical disease manifests when this goes into the mycelial phase. And the main predisposing factor for PV is hot and humid environment. So characteristically, what we see is a hypo or hyperpigmented lesions. And these have a very well-defined borders. You can see well-defined borders. And these lesions, they coalesce to form large patches. Usually, the lesions are very asymptomatic. Sometimes there can be some inflammation. And in KOH, we see the characteristic spaghetti and meatball appearance. So this is a confluent pityriasis versicolor lesion. And in the top, you can see a hyperpigmented pityriasis versicolor lesion. In the below, there is a scaly lesion. So that is why the name pityriasis versicolor, multiple colors, multiple scaling, everything is there. So treatment for all this, main modality of treatment is topical antifungals, imidazole creams, as I told you. In pediatrics, I prefer miconazole followed by clotrimazole. Then luliconazole is nowadays being used. You can apply creams, lotions, or spray. Sprays are very convenient for whole body applications. And we can use ketoconazole shampoos, selenium sulfate shampoos, even soaps, antifungal soaps are available for daily bath. And as a single dose fluconazole at 400 mg, we give it for adolescents. A single dose of fluconazole is very effective for pityriasis versicolor. Now coming to a close DD of pityriasis versicolor, what we see is pityriasis alba. Here, we usually see a ill-defined scaly hypopigmented macule. It's predominantly seen on the face and upper trunk. Usually, this is a minor predisposing factor lesion to atopic dermatitis. So here we have this individual lesion, which is irregularly, very ill-defined, sometimes rounded, oval or irregular plaque, with usually skin-colored, with fine lamellar or brawny scaling. Sometimes there can be some inflammation also in the area, but very rare. And the management mainly is using moisturizers. Continue using moisturizers. You have to reassure the patient, ask them to continue for, might take months, and the pigmentation to return, it can take months. Then coming to the another is viral infections. One of the most common thing we see is molluscum contagiosum. So we can see this discrete translucent papules. Some papules can be umbilicated. So it just affects any cutaneous surface. And you can see the characteristic auto-inoculation causing lesions in the nearby area. And giant lesions, it's a sign of, giant lesions can be seen in sexually transmitted infection and immunodeficient cases. It's a self-limiting condition. So treatment is basically chemical cautery, that is, we use phenol cautery or potassium hydroxide, which we use for this potassium hydroxide, which we use for this KOH mount. The same thing, 10% KOH can be given, and the parents can be asked to apply it over the lesions overnight for 2 to 3 weeks. So that is also a form of chemical cautery. Other treatment modalities are cryotherapy, and we can do needle curettage. We can just curette the lesion with the needle, but it's not very convenient to do it in the children. Another topical modalities of treatment available, that is imiquimod cream, it can be applied over the lesions overnight. Again, it causes severe. You make sure that you don't apply over the normal areas because it can cause contact dermatitis and irritation there. Another easily available topical modality is topical retinoids, tretinoin cream, 0.025% and 0.5%. It can be applied over this lesion overnight for 2 to 3 weeks. Again, you can give oral zinc also as an immunomodulator for speedy recovery. Another common viral infection we see is warts, which is caused by human papilloma virus. Again, these are asymptomatic lesions, but it is cosmetically disfiguring. So we can see discrete skin color papules with a verrucous surface with tiny black speck that is usually seen in the palmar and palm plantar variety of warts. The flat warts, which you see in this picture, it's seen on the face and leg. These are smooth skin colored papules. Then the other warts we see are the plantar warts, palmar warts, genital warts, periungual warts under the nail beds, and filiform warts. So these are the palmar warts, plantar wart, that is the filiform wart over that eyelid, and that is condyloma acuminata or the genital wart. So you can see this verrucous surface, dermal skin colored papule. And over the plantar wart, you can see this thrombose vessels, which give this black specks over that lesion. A close DD for plantar wart is cones. But in cones, you don't see this black specks. Now the treatment warts are usually self-limiting, but we can give topical salicylic lactic acid combinations, which are available in the market. Another treatment modalities are cryotherapy, chemical cautery, electrocautery, topical imiquimod, and for multiple big lesions, we give intralesional MMR, BCG, etc., so that it stimulates the immune, it's as an immunomodulator, and it will cause faster regression of the lesions. Lasers are also available nowadays, and oral zinc, cimetidine, ranitidine also are given as immunomodulators. Next, I'll be rushing through this hand, foot, and mouth disease. We all know it's a Coxsackie A16 virus infection. We see this vesicles and papules distributed over the hands, foot, and mouth. Then herpes simplex, another common viral infection caused by HSV-1. You can see the characteristic lesion is this grouped vesicles on an erythematous base. And when the mucous membrane is involved, you can see an erosion. And this is a very superficial vesicle. So most commonly, it involves the oral cavity, lips, nose, cheeks, fingers, face. The primary lesion, it's usually painful. When the recurrent herpes infection occurs, it's not that painful. And usually the lesions won't be, it will be usually unilateral and less painful. Now, diagnosis of herpes simplex, main thing is clinical diagnosis by this group vesicles. Then sang smear, which will show giant cells and acantholytic cells. And the treatment for oral herpes simplex is oral acyclovir, 15 mg/kg in 3 divided doses for 7 days. There is no role for topical acyclovir in herpes simplex. Plus, we can give, if there is secondary infection, we can give oral antibiotics and topical mupirocin, especially if the lesions are involving the perioral or nose region, because that dangerous area of face. Then another common infection is chickenpox caused by varicella zoster. It is characterized by this teardrop vesicles, which has a first appears in the trunk, followed by extremities, and mucous membrane and mouth, throat all are involved, and the characteristic teardrop vesicles. Treatment, as you all know, is acyclovir, 20 mg/kg per dose, 4 doses per day for 5 days per orally. And for severe disease, we can IV acyclovir. Now, valacyclovir has also been used in treatment for chickenpox and herpes zoster. Again, rushing through this, measles, it's caused by RNA virus, paramyxovirus. You have this erythematous maculopapular rash starting after 2 to 4 days of fever, and it leaves back a brawny pigmentation. And the characteristic features, diagnostic feature of measles is coplic spots, which are these tiny white spots that is like stands of grain seen on the mucous membrane opposite the cheeks of the lower molars. Then another common exanthem we see nowadays is rubella, not seen much. It's characterized by innumerable discrete rose pink macules, which first appear on the face, then it becomes generalized, and the coalesce and spread over the, and usually disappear by the third day. It's caused by an RNA virus. There is no prodromal symptoms. And the most characteristic feature of rubella is the involvement of suboccipital and posterior auricular and cervical lymph nodes. Then another papillomavirus disorder we see is epididymitis rosea. The etiology is not clear, but it is characterized by single annular erythematous lesions. That's the first lesion is called the herald patch. It is a bigger lesion with a peripheral collarette of scale. It's mainly situs mainly on the trunk. It spreads then from there, it spreads to the upper arms and thighs. There are multiple, many varieties of pityriasis rosea. The commonest variety, it is distribution is along the trunk and spreads to the upper arm and thighs, and it gives an inverted fir tree appearance. And the rash usually spontaneously clears in about 6 weeks. So this is the characteristic lesion of pityriasis rosea. You can see this inverted fritry appearance on the back. This is the herald patch, that is the first lesion, that is a papilloscamous lesion with the collarette of scales. And you can see this in that on the trunk of the baby, you can see this collarette of scales and this papilloscamous lesion. It's a self-limiting disease. Just need to give emollients. If there is any signs of inflammation, you can give mild topical steroids and antihistamines. Then coming to the infestations, most commonly seen here is scabies. It's caused by the mite, and the sites you can see it's in the wrist, the border of the hands, the sides of the fingers. You can see the scabitic burrows. And in infants, the genitalia, palms, soles are all involved. And in children, sometimes the head and neck can also be involved. The characteristic feature of scabies is that it is worse in the night. And the treatment is, you have to treat all family members. Hypothermia should be applied head down. And, from the neck to all parts of the body, you can apply it overnight and wash it on the next day. The other alternative available is ivermectin lotions are available now. Ivermectin cream and lotions, that is another alternative to permethrin, which we can apply nowadays. And you have to give antihistamines to control itching. Again, you have to give, the itching will persist for around 2 to 3 weeks. It is because of the hypersensitivity reaction to this. So the itching can persist. So you have to reassure the parents that you'll have to give antihistamines for 2 to 3 weeks. And again, if some active lesions are there, you need to repeat the permethrin application after 2 to 3 weeks. Again, disinfection of the clothing, linens, everything has to be done. And family members, all household members have to be treated. Now, oral ivermectin is being given to treat scabies. Oral ivermectin in the dose of 200 microgram per kg. Ideally, it's an off-label, it is advised only after 12 years, but off-label, we are giving it from 6 years of age. A single dose of ivermectin, 200 microgram per kg, can be given for scabies. Next is spediculosis capitis. Again, it is confined to the suboccipital region and the posterior auricular and temporal region. As you all know, this poor hygiene is a very important predisposing factor. So secondary pyoderma and eczematization can occur. So oozing, crusting, and occipital lymphadenopathy will be there. So treat the secondary infection if there is any, clean debridement of the crusts and scales that should be done. And the treatment is 1% permethrin. In scabies, it was 5% permethrin ointment which we were giving. Here it is 1% permethrin lotion which is available. Again, ivermectin lotions are also available. Can be applied on the after treating the infection, you can apply it over the scalp and all on the hair shaft also, so that it will take care of the nits also. And repeat this application after 3 weeks. And you have to maintain proper hygiene also. Now coming to a common vascular reactions we see in our OP, that is urticaria or angioedema. Now this is a hypersensitivity reaction, and it is characterized by evanescent, well circumscribed, pruritic, edematous, erythematous plaques that we call veals. And angioedema is when the loose subcutaneous tissue is involved. So angioedema involves the lips, scrotum, eyelids, acral parts of the extremities, earlobes, etc. So where loose subcutaneous tissue is there, angioedema is present. Urticarial lesions usually last less than 24 hours, and angioedema can last more than 24 hours. And we call it acute urticaria when the duration of symptoms is less than 6 weeks duration. And if the symptoms are persisting even after 6 weeks, we call it chronic urticaria. And you all know the various causes of urticaria: infection, infestations, inhalation, all those eyes. I'm not going into the detail here. So the main treatment for urticaria, acute urticaria, first we have to take a proper history and identify the triggering factors. Then oral antihistamines. We prefer the first generation antihistamines like hydroxyzine, because it has a it also gives the sedative property. It helps for proper sleep, and so that is more preferred. And in case of if it is chronic, we can change on to cetirizine, loratadine, etc. And in cases of angioedema, it's better to give a short course of oral steroids, 0.5 to 1 mg per kg prednisolone will be enough. And find the cause and treat it accordingly. Another next common thing we see nowadays, now that the mosquitoes are out, that is papular urticaria or insect bite reaction. So you classically you see recurrent eruptions or papules over the exposed part. That is an acquired hypersensitivity to the insect bite. So you can characterization, you can see the punctum on the papules, that is where the insect has bitten. So it's characteristically seen in the exposed areas. So treatment, again, antihistamines can be given and topical steroids, then soothing lotions like calamine can be given. And if there is extensive lesion, a short course of systemic steroids is also helpful. And ask the parents to make the child wear covered clothing. And in chronic cases, sometimes we do give Dapsone. Another common dermatitis we are seeing nowadays is this blister beetle dermatitis or Peters dermatitis. It is an irritant contact dermatitis caused by a beetle belonging to the Peters genus. So overnight, like it is a sudden, the patient wakes up on the one fine morning and sees these erythematous, edematous lesions with pain and burning sensation. So there will be small blisters, pustules, and these lesions are like coalescing lesions. And the pain, there is a sharp pain. That is one characteristic feature of this blister beetle dermatitis, very acute onset. So the treatment is, you have to, if there is cusping and pustules, you can just give some saline compresses, followed by topical steroids and antibiotics, and oral antibiotics if there is extensive superficial infection, bacterial infection. Another infestation we see in our OP is cutaneous larva migrans. This is caused by this hookworm of dogs and cats belonging to the ankylostoma species. So this is a creeping eruption. You can see this creeping nature that is moving under the skin. This creeping eruption, which is slightly raised, flesh colored or pink, and it does intense itching. So the treatment is an antihelminthic albendazole. I give albendazole for 3 days consecutively. Mebendazole or a single dose ivermectin is enough. And if there is secondary infection, you can give topical antibiotics or oral antibiotics if multiple lesions are there, and antihistamines for itching. Then the most common chronic skin infection we see in our practice, that is atopic dermatitis. So this is a chronic relapsing dermatitis seen in children. So there are 3 types of atopic dermatitis. So the infantile type, here the lesions are mainly on the face and extensor surfaces. You can see this papules and plaques with the extensive itching, crusting, and oozing. And the next type is childhood type. Here, this polymorphous lesion, and it usually involves the flexures. You can see this flexure. And it is in tinea, it won't be this erythematous. And the tinea, it can be unilateral. But the flexural dermatitis in atopy, it's usually bilateral. Bilateral involvement is there, and you can see this polymorphous manifestations. And in adults and adolescents, that is the chronic type, where you can see lichenification and excoriations. Lichenification is a characteristic feature. You can see lichenified plaques in the flexures, wrists, ankles, and generalized. So the main principal features of atopic dermatitis is the severe pruritus. It has a chronic relapsing force, and this typical morphology seen in infant type, childhood type, and adult type. And there will be a history of atopic disease with allergic rhinitis, migraine, and asthma. There is one clinical criteria to diagnose atopic dermatitis. So as per this criteria, you should have at least 3 major and minor features to diagnose atopic dermatitis. So the most major features, as I told you, is this pruritus, this typical morphology and distribution, followed by this chronic relapsing dermatitis. And the minor features are the xerosis, that is dry skin, which is a very characteristically seen in atopic children. Pityriasis alba, as I told you earlier, it is a minor feature of atopic dermatitis. Ichthyosis, nipple eczema, dermatographism, Denny Morgan folds, all this. So these are some common things atopic dermatitis we see in our practice. Keratosis pilaris, this is this keratotic follicular prominence, spiny prominence, it's usually seen in the extensor aspect over the buttocks, etc. Ichthyosis vulgaris, then keratoconus of the eyes, then Denny Morgan folds, the fissuring of the palms, perioral dermatitis, a characteristic feature of atopy, xerosis, erythema. So the treatment basically is emollients. Xerosis is the main, this dryness, it is worsens the itching. So liberal application of emollients is the mainstay of treatment of atopic dermatitis. If there is oozing acute, in acute eczema, that is if there is oozing and crusting, you have to give saline compresses, oral antibiotics, because staph infection is the is a common secondary bacterial infection which seen in atopic dermatitis. So you give a proper antibiotic, you advise saline compresses, you can give topical antibiotics if needed. Then when the lesions are dry, you have to start emollients. Emollient treatment is the mainstay of treatment, and the parents have to be advised to continue this emollient treatment for a long duration. Then topical steroids are the next line of management. Moderate potency steroids for severe dermatitis and mild potency steroids for localized areas. So moderate potency, here, betamethasone valerate is a moderate potent steroid which we can use. Then milder steroids, what we usually use is desonide, clobetasone, and hydrocortisone for face and genital regions. And antihistamines has to be given. and for when there is a severe generalized dermatitis, then we have to start oral steroids. Then other other steroid sparing agents which we are regularly using nowadays is cyclosporin. Oral cyclosporin can be given for severe atopic dermatitis. Petechiae salvae, I'm skipping. Now coming to some common hypopigmented lesions. So as I told you, the most common thing we see is Tinea versicola, then Petechiae salvae. Another thing is early vitiligo. Not very common, but still you can see vitiligo cases coming with coming to our OP. So here it is hypo or depigmented macules. And these macules, they develop in a previously normal skin. And in vitiligo being a chronic disorder, you can see this corneurization also. And the hairs in the vitiligo lesion, usually they lose their melanin and are white in color. Sorry for this picture, but here you can see this graying of hair in the patch there. Another common diagnosis we need to keep in mind when we see this facial hypopigmented lesions is indeterminate leprosy. Leprosy is not very common, but still we do see. During my post-graduation, I saw two cases of indeterminate leprosy. One child had his father had a lepromatous leprosy. That was a migrant laborer, and other Malayali only grandfather had lepromatous leprosy, and this child had this ill-defined white patch. Being the face is the most common area being involved, so the sensation usually it is intact in indeterminate leprosy. But if you examine carefully, it will be very dry because of the autonomic nerves involvement. And it's a very fine, scaly, dry patch, which is seen in the face. So when you see hypopigmented lesions of the on the face, always keep this as a diagnosis, because keep in mind, because we shouldn't miss a case of leprosy. And usually, this is a posibacillary type of leprosy. And sometimes if the immunity of the baby is good, it can heal. But if the immunity is down, it can progress on to tuberculoid type of leprosy. Then another common thing, I'm rushing through this, seborrheic dermatitis or cattle crab. You have this greasy scale seen on the scalp of the newborn. It's usually non-inflammatory, but it can proceed on to inflammatory type also. So treatment is basically we give mild baby shampoos, and for severe cases we can give selenium sulfate shampoos or ketoconazole shampoos, and topical mild corticosteroids like hydrocortisone or desonide can be given for the for extensive lesions. Now, madam, should I carry on? Madam, excuse me.
Let me and you know, okay. How many slides are remaining?
Like some.
Can you show important slides? Important cases?
Not all the routine cases we see, ma'am. That's all.
You can just rush through.
Yeah. So these are some the birthmarks which are we usually see. The salmon patch. Again, it's seen on the face and neck. It's nothing to see, it spontaneously disappears. And the port vein nevus, which is the vascular birthmark, it's a vascular malformation, and it persists throughout life. So here we do treatment, and we do treat this with pulse dye lasers and excision grafting. Then another common capillary hemangioma, we do treat this condition if the it usually involves this face, and if it involves the means larger lesion involving the major structures, like if it is obstructing the eye or the nasal cavity, etc., we need to, or it is ulcerating, we need to manage these lesions. For smaller lesions, I give topical timolol. Timolol eye drops are available. This timolol eye drops we apply it over the lesions. And for extensive lesion, oral propranolol, that is 1 milligram per kg, is given, and it resolves. smaller lesions, it just resolves all by itself. But for bigger lesions, ulcerating lesions, the lesions which obstruct the major structures, we give treatment. Melanocytic nevi. If there is a giant congenital melanocytic nevi, you just take a MRI scan and rule out leptomeningeal involvement. And the last one is Stevens-Johnson syndrome and toxic epidermal necrolysis. These are the severe drug reactions involved, and there will be large areas of epithelial necrosis. SJS, when less than 10% of the body area is involved with the mucosal involvement, when the severe, and the child will be very severely sick. That is SJS. When 10 to 30% of the involvement is there, we call it SJS-TEN complex. And if the more than 30% of the skin surface is involved, we call it TEN, toxic epidermolysis, necrolysis. So this is a SJS baby with mucosal involvement. Conjunctiva involvement is very important. You need to take care of the eye also. So treatment is basically discontinue the offending drug followed by fluid and electrolyte imbalance. We give IVIG, IV steroids, and you need to prevent bacterial infections and prevent conjunctival scarring also. So this is a another case of TEN. This is involvement of epidermal necrosis involving more than 30% of the body surface area. So that is it. Thank you.
Thank you, Smita. It was a very informative talk, a bit extensive, but I couldn't stop you because it was very interesting, and you could maintain 95 participants till now. It is dinner time, but even then, there were 90 to 95 participants, so that is, I didn't stop. Can we answer the queries? There are a few queries.
Yeah, we can take questions.
Yeah. Smita, till what age oral thrush is not due to immunodeficiency? It's a question from Bennett, sir.
Excuse me, sir?
Smita, till what age oral thrush is not due to immunodeficiency?
Till what age?
No, my question is, I can tell you, explain the question. Because in early childhood, like infancy time, oral thrush is almost common. But what I learned earlier is, it is a sign of immunodeficiency also. So,
it should be
a normal thing.
Persisting lesion, extensive esophageal candidiasis, etc. Then we think about simple lesions, which subsides with 1 or 2 weeks treatment, we need an
suppose a 10-year-old child is getting the same lesion, still it is considered okay if the child is getting treatment, getting improvement.
Sometimes they have been taking oral antibiotics or anything, sometimes we do get, but it's very less common in bigger children. I usually see it in the infants only.
Okay, thank you.
The next question is by Matthew Bergie. How to manage for a case of severe eczema which is resistant to steroid cream?
Steroid cream. Basically, topical creams we give only for localized. If there is some generalized, we can always go in for oral steroids. So topical only for localized, milder cases. If there is extensive lesions, severe eczema, then we'll have to go to systemic steroids.
Okay. Now, vitreous Albert, there is one question, but it has already been discussed. And leprosy AD for PAS, I think that is also been discussed. And the next question is from Dr. Amit. Young infant with varicella zoster, if the voice is stable, is oral acyclovir enough or should we go parallel?
Excuse me, madam, it's not clear.
Young infant with varicella zoster, if otherwise stable, is oral acyclovir enough or should we go for parenteral?
Infants.
Young infant with the varicella zoster.
Varicella zoster. If the baby is clinically normal, we can always go with oral. Otherwise, there is no severe. Usually, we give oral only, and I think in the newborn period we give IV. That too for only severe herpes. This thing. Otherwise, we always give oral only, madam.
Okay. Now, Dr. Jason has any mild steroids in scabies over the lesions? Scabies, mild steroids.
If there is severe inflammation, mild maybe, but I don't think it has much role because the itching is not due to the lesion per se. It's the hypersensitivity reaction which is happening. So we have to give it oral antihistamines only. Steroid basically doesn't have much role, but if there is severe itching, eczematization happening, secondary eczematization, we can give a mild steroid. That's all.
Okay. Dr. Arthur Ajay has asked, can we apply 5% permethrin on head and neck in a child if there are scabies lesions in head and neck?
Nowadays, we do apply, madam. As per the off-label, we are applying nowadays. Because extensive lesions are seen in children in the head and neck region. So we do apply because 1% permethrin lotion, we are anyway applying for pediculosis and all. So not much problem. We are using it. So off-label.
Okay. Now, what is the role of adrenaline in urticaria? Adrenaline in urticaria.
Adrenaline has role only in anaphylaxis. No rule in
urticaria. Okay. Now, another question from Arun Maman. What is the treatment of keratosis pilaris and how long treatment?
This is a chronic relapsing thing. You have to give emollients and topical steroids. That's all. Similar to atopic dermatitis. But again, it will recur. So that is a chronic relapsing course. When it is too much problematic, you give treatment. Otherwise, just emollients will do. Topical steroids can be given.
Okay. What is the role of coconut oil in atopic dermatitis?
Any oil is okay if the baby is tolerating. Any oil is okay. But you have to apply oil or emollients.
Okay. Now, what is the role of vitamin D in atopic dermatitis? Dr. Arthira is asking.
Vitamin D.
D.
D, yeah. There are a lot of studies means asking to supplement vitamin D. Then probiotics, all these studies are there. Multiple trials are going on. Not much of any conclusive inference is there. But again, if if there is extensive dermatitis involving all over the body, there is no harm in supplementing vitamin D, but there is no conclusive proof that it has some positive effect on atopic dermatitis.
Okay. One question from Dr. Joe Goodwill. For hemangioma, how long will you give propranolol?
Sir, it depends on the resolution of lesions. There are certain criteria we have there. And it's depending on the 2 months is what, I'll just check it. It's 2 months, I think. We can give it for 2 months. We have to do some preliminary investigations and we have to follow it up. If there is any bradycardia, etc. developing, we stop it there. Or we can give it till 2 months, I think. I'll just check it. I'm not very sure of it.
Okay. Then, in newborn, which topical antifungal is preferred?
Newborn.
Question from Dr. Kurian B. Chako. Newborn
developing fungal topical superficial fungal infection is pretty rare, but in PD basically clotrimazole and metronidazole is the one we use normally.
Okay, so that was the last question. Now, thank you, Dr. Smitha. Sir.
Hello. Okay.
Now we have come to the end of our program.
Oh,
I don't know whether Balachandra sir, Aranan sir is here to conclude. Bennett sir.
Hello. Thank you, Priya.
Yeah.
It was an excellent presentation by both Ashokumar sir and Smita. Thank you very much for both the speakers. It's a good occasion, and thank you very much. Thank you, Priya, for conducting this program very well. And it is a very long time. Thank you for attending this program. Thank you.
Okay, so let me wind up this program. So with your permission, let me.
Yeah,
okay, we'll end the program. Thank you very much.